Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started real quick now, y'all, okay? Because we have a lot to cover today. We have a lot. We have some amazing, amazing panelists. Hello, hello, hello. Happy, happy Thursday. My name is Jazz Broughton, and I will be your moderator and your host for today. Good afternoon. Today, we're going to be here for our medical career panel, Health is Wealth, Oakland Promise's first medical career panel that we're going to be having every Thursday from 4 to 5 p.m. Today, we're going to be touching base on the medical career field. Thank you for everyone who made this possible. Again, my name is Jazz, College Access Coordinator for Oakland Promise, and a recent graduate of UCLA Class of 2020. Today, I will be introducing a brilliant assortment of professionals across the medical field that will delve into their personal experiences, everyday lives, and obstacles they've overcome to be where they are today. To start off our amazing set of panelists, I would like to introduce Lizette Pacias. So, Lizette has been a registered nurse for nearly 6 years and is currently working as a bedside labor and delivery nurse, as well as a nursing clinical instructor through California State University Stanislaus. There, she prepares nursing students for the start of their own careers as practitioners. So she's doing some amazing work, and she received both her bachelor's in anthropology and her master's of science in nursing education at CSU Stanislaus, where she continues to leave her legacy. Allison Purcell has a master's in education from UC Berkeley and has been an admission counselor at Samuel Merritt University, excuse me, y'all, in Oakland for almost 4 years, where she works recruiting working nurses for various programs. So she is passionate about helping people on their educational journey, providing with tools, resources, support that they need to achieve their ultimate success as working nurses. So we're really excited to hear more from her and Lizette. We also have an amazing Patrick Prado, who is an epidemiologist working on COVID and HIV research, primarily focusing on health disparities here in the San Francisco Bay Area and in the global South. He is currently working as a data scientist, working with COVID mass testing for Latinx populations who, as we all may know, have been disproportionately impacted by the pandemic. Connie Ngo was born and raised in Oakland and graduated from Oakland High School in 2008, woo woo, oh hi baby, where she then went to UC Davis for her bachelor's of science in neurobiology, physiology, and behavior, okay? Following undergrad, Connie pursued a nursing degree from an accelerated program at Azusa Pacific University in Southern California. And since then, she has been working as a surgical and trauma ICU nurse and is currently pursuing higher education to become a family nurse practitioner at no other than the Samuel Merritt University, where Allison is also working, okay? We have our amazing panelist, Dr. Stephanie Jonakin. Stephanie has been for 6 help manage their medication, do a variety of other work. She has received her bachelor's of science at Kentucky State University, but returned to California for pharmacy school, where she continues to excel in her work. So I want to thank all of our panelists for taking the time out of their busy schedules to be here with us today, sharing their words of wisdom. And I also want to take time to thank all of our students, scholars, parents, families, and counselors who have helped make this event possible. Please engage in the chat, write down all of your questions that come up, and feel free to follow us on our social media at OP Future Center and at Oakland Promise Scholars to stay tuned to future events, panels, and other awesome opportunities. We received some phenomenal feedback and questions in the RSVP form, which y'all filled out, so thank you so much. And so with no further ado, let's increase our health and wealth. Panelists, I know you all do a variety of work, so could you just briefly kind of give us a layout of what is an average day in your career look like? And Allison, we'll start with you.
Okay, thank you. Welcome everyone. So again, my name is Allison and I'm an admission counselor at Samuel Merritt University, a health sciences school with strong ties to Oakland. So I'm not a healthcare professional, but I help students on their journey to becoming nurses and advanced practice nurses. And I love it. I love my day-to-day, getting to communicate with folks through email and phone calls, hosting sessions like this to tell folks about the different opportunities and the different pathways to nursing. Thank you.
That's awesome. Thank you, Connie. Go ahead.
My name is Connie. I'm a surgical and trauma ICU nurse at a level one trauma and teaching hospital. I actually work night shift, so 7 p.m. to 7:30 in the morning. In the ICU, we're responsible for 1 to 2 critically ill patients. So in my unit, we usually see patients from like car accidents and complicated surgeries, falls, even like gunshot wounds. And our duties there include almost everything, which is something I liked about it, that we can take care of people who really can't take care of themselves at that moment. We take care of their meds, their labs, if they're on a ventilator, a dialysis machine, if they have drains coming out of their brains, and just also being there for the patient and their families for whatever that they need. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lizette. So to follow Connie, I want to talk to you about what I do for a living. So I am a labor and delivery nurse. And I want to talk about like the common little misconception that comes with being an L&D nurse. So I thought, and I think a lot of people think that it's more kind of like postpartum where you work with babies, but it's labor and delivery. So these are women who are doing work, you know, to have their babies. But I want to just briefly talk about kind of what my day looks like. So we actually, Connie works in a specialized area. So just like me. So in that sense, our floors are kind of similar because you're taking care of 1 to 2 either really sick patients or like maybe, you know, laboring patients. So we can't have too many. Typical nursing will look like 4 up to 5, 6 on the floor is what we call it. And you have every single skill in nursing school, but then there's us and it's a little more specialized. So I also work night shift 7 to 7. When I show up to work, I change actually into scrubs. So we can't wear the scrubs that that we bring from home because of infection control reasons. But we clock in, we get huddle, and then we get report from the day shift nurse. And then we just go take care of our patients. However, our floor labor and delivery is different because there's so many roles you can play. So in that, and that's something that I wanted to bring up. So there's a recovery nurse. So people who are recovering from surgery, there's the operator nurse who circulates is what we call it. And you manage, you basically provide a safe environment for whoever's having surgery, which for us, it would be C-section, sometimes hysterectomies where they take out the uterus, or sometimes people who tie their tubes, things like that. So there's all these different procedures in the realm of women in the OR there. And then there's triage, which is basically an ER for pregnant people. So we just triage them and then decide whether or not they're staying. So it's, and then there's laboring women. You know, we help them have their babies where they're for the biggest moment. So that's kind of what our day looks like. It's unexpected. Never know where I'm going to be. Never know what I'm going to be doing. And of course, lots of charting and passing meds and checking vitals and taking care of them, doing cervical checks, determining how dilated they are. So it's big and complex and really fun.
Thanks, Lizette. I'll go after you. My name is Patrick Prado. I'm an informatics epidemiologist. I work at the University of California, San Francisco. And like Jazz mentioned, I work in data systems and primarily in data analysis, dashboard designs. My day, unlike the previous panelists, is a lot more predictable. Right now we're gearing up to have some mass testing events in Latinx focused communities. So anything from like programming the surveys to coding them and analyzing them in R, which is a analytical program, and then visualizing it on dashboards so that people can make decisions and people can, you know, take this data and get information out of it. And then in my previous roles before, I guess COVID happened, I used to travel to sub-Saharan Africa quite a lot to advise on data and data systems that was more HIV focused. Thanks, everyone.
Hi, my name is Dr. Jonakin. I'm actually a clinical pharmacist for the Department of Veteran Affairs. So I basically take care of all of our military, our retired military. And on a day-to-day basis, basically, I open up the pharmacy. We do a narcotic count. So all of those heavy drugs that people tell you to stay away from, I'm basically like in control of that and have to make sure that we're DEA compliant. All of the different parts in the hospital or the clinic, whether it be for the nurses or the individual doctor's clinics, whenever they need medications, they let me know and we fill their orders so that they have drugs on hand in their specific clinics. We do a lot of ordering. So the vaccines that everyone is getting, they usually go through pharmacy first for quality control, and then they are dispensed to the various sectors of the hospital or clinic. I pretty much process orders. So the doctor will write a prescription. I verify, make sure that the medication and the dose is correct for the patient based off of, you know, their history, their medical diseases, and just kind of verify labs just to make sure that that medication can also be processed by that particular patient. And then I also dispense the medication so that I can properly counsel patients on the drugs that they're getting, the medications that they're getting for whichever disease state, whether that be for pain, diabetes, hypertension, blood clots, any of the various diseases.
Wow, that is so amazing. You guys all do a variety of work across the medical field, and it's all so unique and important in its own way. And that kind of just makes me go into, some of you talk about maybe what made you decide to pursue a career? Like, how did you end up where you are? What kind of inspired you to choose this pathway?
Well, I became a pharmacist because two different reasons. One, I could actually see the improvement that people had in their daily lives whenever they take medications. And I also was able to see the detrimental side effects of people that abuse and take medications that they may not know a lot about. So going to pharmacy school, you basically learn how drugs are made, how to make drugs yourself, how they're processed in the body, and the side effects that occur whenever you take medications.
I can go next. Thanks, Jazz. I guess I wanted this career, basically, as soon as I learned about it, I didn't learn about it until I got a job in it sort of after college, but it deals more with like population health and at the level of population versus a lot of our panelists here, which are more sort of like direct support, like person to person. And sort of I wanted more of that high level population view in order to, you know, see how sickness is in communities that we practice in. So. Yeah, thanks.
That's great. Does any of our panelists want to also talk a little bit more about maybe what motivated them to choose the career that they're in before we get into some of the steps they had to take to get there?
I actually want to add something.
Thanks. Yes, please.
So when I went into college, I wasn't too sure of exactly what I was going to do. So I actually had to do a lot of soul searching. And I ended up doing I was lucky to get a lot of internships. And I searched everywhere. I tried dentistry, chiropractor. I thought about going into accounting, public health. But I realized I kind of had to prioritize it down to what was important to me. And I just definitely wanted a career that was stable and flexible, and it was something that was going to utilize my strengths. And I also wanted it to be something that I was really passionate about. And I love learning about health. And I think if there's nothing else for me to give, it's that I can be kind and just care for somebody while they're going through like the toughest part of their life. And as I was doing all this searching, and I interned at in the hospital at the ICU, nursing fell into my lap, and I just realized it met all my requirements and everything I was looking for. And so it kind of took a lot of searching for me to find this career, but it finally hit, checked all the boxes.
That's so awesome. Thank you so much, everyone, for that insight. And now I know we got some questions in the chat. Please keep them coming. Shannon, we had a great question on, you know, what did you major in undergraduate studies? I know that this was particularly for Dr. Jonathan. So just keeping that in mind, you know, Dr. Jonathan, you could look in the chat and just start seeing that we have that going into sort of what are some of those steps? What are some things that students can take, programs, classes? And something else I want to add to this real quick is, you know, there's this notion that any career in the medical field takes this long time, years to get, and requires a bunch of schooling. And just kind of going into what are some of the credentials that you had to do? Can you tell us a little more about how long it actually took for you to get to where you are now? And, you know, again, what are some of those steps you took? And then also, Lizette and Allison, maybe you could elaborate a little further on the steps you took and colleges you may recommend for nursing, Connie, the nursing, and then also pharmaceuticals, Lizette. Just all of that.
Sure, Shannon. That was a great question. So, whenever you're applying to graduate school, a lot of times people are majors in biology, biochemistry, organic chemistry, or just chemistry. Usually, they have a major in science. But how I was able to stand out was I double majored and in biology and theater arts. So the theater arts portion allowed people to see that, you know, I had a sense of like community. I was able to speak and didn't have a problem addressing people that I didn't know. So they kind of look for those things as well. And when you go in for your interview, they definitely make sure that you can talk in large crowds. But I did 4 years of undergrad and then 4 years of grad school and then 1 year of residency. So altogether, that's about 9 years of schooling. And nowadays, they also recommend a second year of residency. Now, granted, when you're doing your PGY1, which is your residency one and two, you are getting paid, but not as much as a full-time, full-fledged pharmacist. It's still part of your education process. There are some six-year programs. So if you know you want to go to pharmacy school, there's about 10 schools, I believe, in the US where you can do 2 years of undergrad prep work and then go straight into pharmacy school. So you won't need to get your bachelor's degree first, whereas I had to get my bachelor's degree first. And then only schools in California don't require the PCAT, which is an exam that you have to take in order to get into pharmacy school. So California is the only state that doesn't require that. All the other states do.
So I can follow with answering for those of you that are interested in nursing, what are the steps to become a nurse? Some of you were asking. So you have to, declare yourself a pre-nursing major. So first you're pre-nursing, you can't just declare yourself a nursing major because that would mean that you're in the nursing program. And then once you're in the nursing program, then you're a nursing student officially. But I know that there's lots of questions about which schools. Basically, the most important thing that I want to talk to you about is accreditation. So look at all of these colleges in the area, whatever fits your financial financial needs. CSUs are obviously great because you're going to graduate with a BSN, but junior colleges are also a way to go. Here's the thing, just to be real with all of you, colleges is a place where you are going to find yourselves and find out whether or not you really want to do this. And it's okay if you do go to junior college before transferring or before going to a four-year university. You could even go to a junior college and then transfer and start nursing school at the four-year university. All these things are possible. So just talk to your counselors. But accreditation, if you ever hear that word, that basically ensures that nursing education programs across the board in the United States are all meeting certain standards. And that's important. They link with the Board of Registered Nursing, with the BRN, to make sure that you're all on the same page. So when you downscale it, what that means is certain clinical hours are met, certain topics are taught, you touch on certain subjects, there are certain regulations. So the most important thing is when you pick your school, just make sure it's an accredited school. And you might hear that nursing is kind of dime a dozen. There's a lot of people who want to be nurses. So typically every program has something that's called like a roadmap or some sort of like checkboxy type of, these are all the classes that you need to become a nurse. And unfortunately, it's almost just that simple. There's so many. I don't even think that nursing has designated counselors. I think you can just go to a counselor and they'll tell you the same thing. So whatever school you're looking at, look at that roadmap, study it, make sure that you check every semester, they could update it. So one semester they might only want organic chem, and then the next semester it'll be regular chemistry. And that part, that just sucks. But I had to just keep checking this roadmap, making sure that it wasn't updated, and then just follow that. So you just take prerequisites, and then shoot for A's. Life happens, but just shoot for A's. It's competitive out there. And then once you're in, it's really hard to stay in. So it's studying hard, it's eye on the prize, and focus on what's in front of you. Don't get overwhelmed with like, I need to go to grad school right now. It's one bite at a time, and that's how you're going to be successful.
Yeah, and I'll follow up with Lizette, and I would echo what she said about schools accreditation. That's really important. You want to make sure that the school is regionally accredited, and then for specific programs like nursing, that they're accredited by particular nursing bodies. And we're really lucky to live here in the Bay Area because we have such a good community college system. And I would always recommend that students try to take prerequisites in the community college system. You don't have to be going to a four-year university to start taking classes toward these health science careers. And like she said, there's a number of prerequisites or specific classes you're expected to have before you get into the nursing program. So like the four sciences, anatomy, physiology, chemistry, microbiology, those are the tough ones for many people. But then, you know, classes like English and history, they're looking for well-rounded students. And what I would say is really important is like she said, shoot for A's and B's. Really try to do well in the classes. So don't overwhelm yourself with a whole bunch of science classes in one semester. If you can map it out, you know, talk to a counselor, but maybe do one, maybe two science classes at a time, because you want to have that mental space to be able to do well and retain that content, because you need those foundational classes to do well in nursing school. And, you know, I look at transcripts a lot with my job as an admission counselor. And, you know, when you see the students that have the C's, it's hard to be competitive. And so my advice to all of you that are, you know, thinking about college or even in college now, if you're struggling, just reach out and get help, get support. You know, don't give up. Just get the support. You know, professors, I think, tend to love that. They want to see students are engaged and are really motivated. So don't feel like you're alone and struggling in classes, because you don't want to have to repeat them. So again, just try to shoot for the A's and B's in the beginning, and get that support that you need, because you do need those foundational classes to be successful in these higher level health sciences, whether it's nursing or pharmacy or, you know, physical therapy, what have you. They're advanced degrees, so that is pretty critical. And Lizette, I did see a question come in about difference between nurses with associates and bachelors. You want to talk about that before we? I don't know if we want to do that now.
Yeah. So I can't speak on all the schools around here, but just to compare the junior college where I graduated with my associates versus the bachelor's degree, it was a 3-class difference. Very important. To admit, it is very important to have these. And one of them was nursing research. So we dove deep into research and how you document it, how you read it. You know, you hear people say, write an article, and then your brain, after taking this class, will do things like, well, what were the limitations and who was the study? And you just learn how to read research, because not everyone knows how. There was also community health, and that was just to show us how there's nurses that practice outside in the community, not just in the four walls of a hospital or a clinic. So that semester, we went out to the community and helped people. And then there was a writing proficiency course, which was higher level, was not an undergrad level. And those were the 3 differences. But essentially, the education that you get at the different schools, it just depends on where you're going, but the approach might be different. So you might be preloaded with all of these skills that you have to do, or they might teach you slowly throughout the program. So that just kind of, it's just a little bit different. Pretty close though.
Awesome. Thank you so much, everyone, all of our panelists. And then also too, we're getting so many great questions in the chat. Can we start thinking about what are some colleges, programs, internships that you recommend for our folks, our high school students, our college students? If you know of anything right now, PPU is killing it in the chat. You was letting them know there's, and I know you're spearheading all this stuff with COVID and, you know, all the, you know, research and how to, maybe you can kind of talk a little bit more about that, but just all the different stuff that's going on right now. Are there any internships, programs? What are some clubs that maybe you did, things that you would recommend that folks take advantage of, both on and off campus? Sorry, I'm about to put Patrick, I'm going to put you on the spot. Do you think you could allow, I know you're like, I'm responding to the chat and stuff. I'm putting you on the spot, Bo, to answer the question of what are some things, just kind of talking about, I know you're doing a lot of HIV work and research and stuff right now with COVID. Do you have any internships or programs that you would recommend to folks, or maybe like things that kind of pushed you, that you're seeing around available?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's slightly different, I think, from a lot of these medical fields, but there are like fellowships and internships, you know, since I'm in public health that the CDC supports, and, you know, applying to the CDC, a lot of getting into this program also is your personal connections, right? So asking around, like Google's your friends, like Googling areas that potentially interest you in your communities, where you live, and, you know, Googling the people that are leading those projects to see if they have any space available for like an internship, or, you know, asking around is never going to hurt you. And, you know, helps you make that personal connection, which, you know, I think personally is better at getting involved in something like an internship rather than just like cold applying using your using a resume or anything like that. So yeah, that's what I would recommend, doing some research. And you know, a lot of it is also discovering what you like, right? I think one of the other panelists here said, you know, that they tried lots of different things. You know, I did too before I realized that public health and epidemiology was something that I wanted to do. Like I did a lot of lab work before this, and I decided, you know, the lab isn't for me. It's for some people it is, but you know, for me, it wasn't. So, you know, being able to try new things, even if you you think you might not like it, just to see what it's all about. Thanks.
Thank you so much for that. Does anyone want to add into recommendations for programs or internships or clubs or, you know, groups on campus that really made a difference for you?
I think when I was in high school, I just joined a lot of the volunteering clubs like He Club. And I was also trying a lot of sports teams. I think that just helps with your discipline and just gets you ready for college, where it is a lot more independent study. And then from there, when you're kind of taking care of your grades and everything, it's just going to make you more competitive when you have to apply to the professional schools. So right now in high school, I would say just focus on getting your study skills together.
I have to agree with that as well. You know, definitely focus on your studies. And if you have the ability,
was that frozen on our end or? Okay. We'll just wait a second for her to get back. Panelists, if you want to start thinking about if you have anything else to add in as well, I'll just give it one more second. Also, panelists, we have a lot of students who are doing dual enrollment classes, so taking community college classes and their high school classes at the same time. So, you know, what GEs do they really need to take? Should they be taking the chemistry and physics or doing all that? You know, can they explore maybe some more simple GEs or general education classes?
Yeah, for those, big piece of advice would be to look at the classes that you're allowed to double dip in, allowed. So if you have, if you guys are interested, let me know in the chat, but I can post this roadmap thing that I was talking about through CSU Stanislaus just to have you see what one would look like that would show all the nursing prereqs. Let me know and I'll share it in the chat. But sometimes when you look at your nursing or your general ed, your general requirement book to graduate from college, sometimes there's nursing prereqs that you can double dip. So it'll be the same category. So if you do that, then you'll take less classes and that would be great.
Awesome. Thank you so much to our Stephanie, you're back. Dr. Jonathan, do you want to finish what you're saying? Sorry about that.
Oh, no, you're fine. I was just saying that I played sports. So I got a full ride to Kentucky State to play volleyball, and it allowed me to have someone else pay for undergrad and allowed me to also focus on what I wanted to do because they had a direct line to a career in medical. And and then if you have, if you go on an athletic your GPA doesn't have to be as high to get into college, and your ACT, depending on what your GPA is, like your ACT and your SAT scores don't have to be as high. So there's a way to like offset one versus the other if you don't quite start off your high school career making nothing but A's.
I think that's a really great point, is finding out all the different, you know, resources and opportunities. Again, increasing your support system. So whether that's sports, whether that's, you know, frats and sororities, whether that's different clubs and fellowships, et cetera, internships, really making sure that you're taking advantage of the virtual campus, the online campus, whatever it is, making those phone calls, sending out those emails, and taking advantage of your talents and skills to not only like to increase your bag of money and financial aid for sure, because that is super important. So everyone, let's take a moment to just recognize all the beautiful hard work, the discipline, all the time and courage that it takes to go into this work. And so now I know folks are wondering, like, is this the right field for me? Is this really what I would want to be doing? And so with that, we're just going to kind of open up the space to start thinking about what are some of the hardest challenges that you have all come into contact with in your career? And also, what are some of the most rewarding aspects of your career? I know, I see Connie's face like, this is a good one. Let me know. I know. Do you want me to popcorn? Yeah, go ahead, Connie.
To be honest, I think the hardest part for me about going into a health field was that it was just very intimidating. I came from a single parent household and my mom didn't go to college. So I was definitely very lost. So I think my biggest problem was confidence. But I just want you guys all to know that you guys can definitely achieve whatever you guys want to. Where there's a will, there's a way. And I think right now, with my job, I think because I want it to be, for it to be challenging, I think the flip side of it is that it's just very physically and emotionally demanding. So also be aware that these careers can be very hard, but it's also very, very, very rewarding. And I can't imagine myself doing anything else that would actually satisfy me. And with that, I would just say that, you know, be aware of your guys' like coping mechanisms and your guys' like attitude, and just focus on having good emotional and mental health. And I think that will like bring you guys a long way. Thank you.
I'd love to follow that. Not being a healthcare practitioner myself, but working with nursing students, and the programs I work with are designed for working nurses. So these are people in the field and have returned to school to advance their careers. And burnout is real. So it's true. Like you really, what we're trying to do at Samuel Merritt, and I think a lot of schools, are helping students to really focus on self-care. You know, you can't serve your communities if you're not full yourself and taking care of yourself. And I think those that are drawn to these professions, you know, you want to help people, you want to have an impact, but you need to make sure that you're taking care of yourself. And so that's something to just be aware of, you know, always take time for yourself and family. And I think that time management is a key part of that. Like, okay, when am I going to study? When am I going to see my family? When am I going to have time to do a little work? And some of these programs you might not be able to work while you're in school because they're so intensive. So it is a lot of sacrifice. And I recognize that working with students, and we recognize that it's a family decision, you know, for working parents out there, like, okay, someone else has to take care of the kids while I'm back in school, or, you know, you might be dealing with taking care of younger siblings. So just be aware of that and try to pool your resources with your support system before you embark on these actual healthcare programs. And there's money out there. So just think about different opportunities that you can explore for scholarships, and there's loan forgiveness options. So we also want to make sure people don't think cost is a barrier. It is a sacrifice to embark on these programs in many ways, whether you're at a state school or private, but just know that there's really good job potential out there. You know, there's such a need for healthcare professionals, and COVID has certainly highlighted that. So it can be a long journey, and it's a lot of hard work, but take care of yourself, know your support system, and just keep plugging away with it.
Any other panelists want to talk about some of the challenges that they faced, or maybe some of the successes and rewards that they most enjoy from their career?
Sure. As far as challenges in my career, I think when I first started practicing, one of the hardest parts was that nobody believed that I was a doctor. So they'd come to my pharmacy and they'd be like, oh, let me speak to the pharmacist. I am the pharmacist. No, you're not a pharmacist. I was somebody else back there. Sir, I'm the only pharmacist here, you know? So having to kind of like defend myself, I don't know if it was, you know, woman of color, but considering I was the only person in the pharmacy, I'm not really sure what they were thinking, but yeah, there's tons of people that challenged me because they didn't believe that I finished with a doctorate in pharmacy. And then even as you go down the line, you experience other things. So when you finally really display your knowledge, you also come across different views on how to prescribe certain medications. And that could be based off of like studies, history, patient information. So that's kind of tricky too, because talking to other medical professionals in a way that doesn't disrupt work, but also gets the patient the best care, can also be challenging. And then there are just some days that it's like, whoops. I mean, that's horrible to say whoops like that. I meant because there's overdoses, there's people who accidentally take medications, or, you know, there's all types of medical errors, medication errors that happen when you're in a pharmacy, when you're in a clinic, when you're in a hospital in general. So those are kind of the hard parts. But the good parts is that you actually get to see, you know, people's health improve. You get to see what good you do in the society, and you really get to educate people to make the best decisions for themselves. So it's really nice.
I have a quick question. What about sometimes when you have to sometimes change the doctor's prescription? How's that?
A vast majority of times, especially if you're dealing with old school doctors that didn't grow up in the world of PAs, DOs, nurse practitioners, those doctors aren't as open to other people's professional opinion. But at the end of the day, especially when you're in a clinic or a hospital, you do have to kind of put your foot down, if you want to say that, because you don't want to give a patient the wrong dose and they bleed out all over the table and have something detrimental happen, you know, because it's easier to give more drug, but it's very hard to take it away.
Thank you so much for that. I love this. Y'all, we spent some real game today. You want to learn about the medical field? Tune in. Okay. And so for that, before we open up the space to some awesome questions in the chat that I see that I want to make sure we touch on, I just really want to quickly just, you know, have the panelists be able to speak some words of wisdom that you would like to leave with the scholars before we open it up for our Q&A. Any words of wisdom that you feel like hasn't really been said, that you were really wanting to say, you know what I mean, before we open it up to the other questions?
I have a couple of words of advice and just food for thought for anyone who's trying to go into the healthcare field. So lots of just tips. So first things first is just have a hobby. And this is after high school. This is once you're in college and you're pursuing whatever it is that you're going to pursue. One of the thing, I think something that my family did tell me, but I ignored, was to not sit and study for 10 to 12 hours a day. It's not beneficial. So, you know, get up, move around, go do something, find something that you love, and stick with it. And then in terms of study, like study tips and tricks, make use of small increments of time that you have. So instead of sitting there for 10 hours, if you're going on a long car ride, take flashcards, or make use of like a bus ride or being on BART or a car ride or whatever transportation, and just use that as like small study time as opposed to cramming yourself always. And then another thing was like to find your why. So this is something that's really common. And I know that there's people who come from long lines of nurses, long lines of doctors. But if you have any family pressure to go into healthcare, it's not beneficial. So if you're going to go into healthcare, it's difficult. You work long hours. The work is difficult. So if your heart's not in it, then find something that you just love and ignore all the noise, because what's meant to be is going to happen and you're going to find something that you love. Promise. College is awesome.
I just want to go off of a little bit of what Lizette was saying. I see in the chat, there's a lot of like, what's the best school to go for this? What's the best school to go for this? How can I be competitive? Like, you know, I think at the end of the day, like, you know, one, you know, we all measure success differently, and you need to make sure to figure that out for yourself, because at the end of the day, whatever it is that you value is going to carry you through, you know, whatever career and whatever path you're choosing. And that's regardless of, you know, what the best school is. So, you know, the best school is the best school for you. Is, you know, you taking the time to research what's important for you. Like, is it the environment? Is it being close to home? Is it getting farther away from home? You know, what type of school, what you want to learn? And, you know, really doing your research before applying. Because I think, you know, we all do measure success differently, right? Like, I, for example, went to an Ivy League school. I went to Columbia University. My twin brother went to a small school in Virginia, a small liberal arts college in Virginia. Like, now he makes twice as much as I do. So, you know, if you want to talk about success, and he has none of the debt. So if you want to talk about success, we all measure success differently. You know, we both definitely have different passions. And so I think you need to think about like less about, you know, how other people view like these institutions and these school institutions that you're applying to, and how you view it versus like how, you know, what's going to carry you forward in your career and what you want to do.
I totally agree with what you guys just said. You know, what you put in is what you get out. It doesn't always matter the name of the school, as long as you're putting your heart into it. I just wanted to give a quick shout out to all the other, I know it's, when I was in high school too, I always called it the medical profession, but I kind of learned to call it pre-health professions, because the health profession includes everything like pharmacy, all the therapists, like physical therapists, occupational speech therapists, the nutritionists, radiologists, social workers. Like, these are all people who play such important parts to getting somebody better and out of the hospital safely, so that they can, you know, thrive at their home or wherever they need to be. So when you guys start looking for your career, don't just think you have to make yourself fit into one profession. There's so many options out there and so many pathways. So there's that. And yeah, when you guys can find internships or shadowing and network, just stay humble. I'm like over a decade out from high school, and I definitely went to a lot of college, but it's so important to still stay humble. And when I don't know something, I just, you know, admit to it, I don't know, but I'm going to be trying my best, or I'm going to try my best to figure that out for you. So just take it all one step at a time. I think you guys are already taking such a big step by being here. So yeah, good job, everyone.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Congratulations, everybody, for being here. Y'all should be giving yourselves a huge squeeze and hug and a big round of applause. Again, I just really, again, huge round of applause, circles of love to everyone. Y'all are amazing. And a lot of these questions, you're not going to get all the answers in 1 hour, you know, and that's why Oakland Promise is here for you to last through your years, honey. We're here for decades. We are here for forever. Okay. So whatever you need, Oakland Promise Scholarship. We also have a high school Excel program that's happening right after this. Is an opportunity to continue to think about, well, what are my leadership styles? What are my career paths that I'm interested in? And we want y'all to know that this is just the beginning to you getting a support system to get some of these questions answered. I know we have, like, you know, what are the differences between medical school in nursing school? You know, if this is some, if I'm interested in orthopedics, like, what does that fall under major wise, you know, stuff like that. Like, these are all such great questions. So let's go ahead and, like, read through the chat. Maybe we can unmute and answer any of these. Our panelists, if you see anything you want to hop on, keep the questions coming. Again, continue to follow us at OP Future Center. We are so excited to be here. Yeah, I mean, does anyone want to hop on that real quick? Nursing versus medical?
Hi. I don't know.
Hey, Edward.
If I'm allowed to, like, yes.
Yeah, say hi. Yeah.
Oh, okay, sounds like I'm allowed to speak. Okay. So, seems like you guys are all...
We can't hear you, Edward.
Oh no, internet connection's unstable. Okay, me. Goodness gracious. How about now?
That's good.
Okay. So my dream profession when I grow up is, I think it's gonna be totally different from you guys. I'm not dreaming of becoming like a doctor necessarily. I mean, I want a doctorate degree, but I wanna be in forensic pathology or chemistry. So I personally feel like it's the steps to get there are this or similar to what you guys took, but if there's anything like different, like, would you be able to, you know, tell me? Thank you.
Do any of our panelists want to hop on and...
Sure. To my knowledge, it is pretty much the same for forensics. A lot of the people that I know, they just got a bachelor's degree. And there's actually schools that where you can major in forensics. And to my knowledge, one of the best forensics colleges in the world is actually in Tennessee. Kind of forgot which one, but it's like the number one where they actually have, you know, bodies buried on some of their property so that the students can actually go in and see the difference between rigor mortis at 1 day versus 10 days versus 35 days versus 6 years. So it's, from my understanding, it's actually a really good program.
No, I heard of that school in a movie. I just don't know the name.
That is awesome. Chloe, do you want to go ahead and unmute and ask your...
So when I'm older, I'd really like to become a nutritionist or a dietitian. What are some good schools to go to become in that job area?
Any of our panelists?
I'm not a nutritionist, so I don't know the specific names of the schools, but when I was looking for schools to go to after my undergrad, Google helped, but I think you want to kind of figure out your priorities, like whether you want to be close to your family, look at the cost of the school, and if you're able to do any internships or shadow, a nutritionist, they'll probably be able to tell you more about those programs.
Okay, thank you.
That's a really great point. And everyone, thinking about your environment, literally Google is our best friend. When I was doing stuff, I'd be like, top international human rights. Like, that's so broad. What does that even look like? Like, what, you know, and you just kind of go with it. And so literally just finding whatever it is. And then that's a big thing. Like, do you want a big school, little school, cloudy, like sunny and snowy? That's really, those kinds of things are really going to be what helps. And then of course your financial aid pack as well. So again, 4:58. Any other questions before we come in? I know we got some really great questions. So make sure that you're following us and you're also emailing us directly, letting us know how we can best support you, especially our high school students out there. We're here for you to keep these questions coming, keep these panels coming. And yeah, all of our students, actually, middle school scholars, everybody. So grateful to have you all here.
This is a really good time for folks to ask their last minute questions while you have the whole panel here.
Keep asking them. I'm going to be here. It's low, right? Ask questions, everybody. Also, too, come through to High School Excel. All my kids, I need y'all to come through. Oh, that's not it. Hold on. I need y'all to come through right now to this program, this workshop that I'm about to lead on what kind of, I hope it takes you there. It's not gonna, hold on, you guys. Oh, me trying to multitask. But please come through right now, learn what kind of leadership style you are. If you are in high school, we want y'all to engage with literally learning about what are some different career paths, how can you take your different personality styles. If you're shy, if you're outspoken, if you are excited, thank you so much, Samra, you're amazing. Please check it out. Go to the link, tune in. We're happening at 5 to 6. And then after that, we're going to be doing our youth town hall. Okay. Come listen to some amazing motivational youth talk about representing our Black community, talking about mental health, and representing our folks. Right. So again, thank you so much, everyone, for being here at our Health is Wealth medical career panel. I love you all so, so much. This is Oakland Promise, you know, fulfilling our promise every day, little by little. I love you guys. Make sure that you email us. Let us know what questions you have. DM us, OP Future Center. Let us know what questions you have. I'm Jazz. I'm always here for you 24/7. You know where to find me. Jazz@oaklandpromise.org, okay? Teamwork makes the dream work. Let me know. Love you guys. Have a great Thursday. Have a great weekend.
Thank you. You too.
Pull up the Coachella. Hey, I got the squad with me. Hey, I brought the squad with me. Black on black diamond on the side. Say it's champagne.
Thank you to all of our panelists. Y'all are amazing. Y'all killed it. Y'all are amazing. Thank you so much. I just want to have a good time. I got to go to this next workshop, y'all, but please, love you all so much.
Y'all are so amazing. You're awesome. Thank you.